Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. Welcome to the 2022 IFAC EdExchange Summit, this year focused on the impact of technology on the accounting profession. For those of you who have not had the privilege of meeting, my name is Helen Partridge, and I'm the Director of Accountancy Education at the International Federation of Accountants. In recent years, technology evolution has changed the way we work and learn, and the pace of change is really just not slowing. Our third annual virtual summit is dedicated to helping professional accountants and the professional accountancy organizations that support us further understand the opportunities, the risks, and the skills needed to take on new technologies that are available to us. Before we hear from Alan Johnson to open the summit, I do have a few administrative comments. First, this is a professional level event where sharing diverse ideas and perspectives is encouraged. As such, IFAC expects all participants to engage respectfully and professionally when participating during this event. Second, this event is being translated live into Arabic, French, Spanish, and Russian. If you haven't already found the channels for such, please check at the bottom of your screen in the Zoom toolbar. And third, during the presentations and discussions today and throughout the conference, you will have an opportunity to ask questions of the presenters, and I really strongly encourage you to do so. To do this, you will need to use the Slido functionality included on the same page where you found the Zoom link to join today. I see a number of you have already found it with the word cloud that's developing on the countries we come from. Slido will also be used to pose questions to you throughout the summit. I ask that you engage with us in these polling questions, the word clouds, et cetera, for two reasons. One, some of you may need these tracked for your CPE or your CPD credits. And two, just like last year, those able to respond to the most Slido polls and clouds will be entered into a prize drawing for some of the books recommended by this year's speakers. There is another reason I would like that. So some of the questions we're asking will inform IFAC's work going forward. The original concept of the summit when IFAC Model for Accountancy Education was established 3 years ago was for education directors of professional accountancy organizations that I work with to hear from experts and then consider what it means for the accountancy education of the profession. However, with the help of technology, we have had the opportunity to share these views and the views of these speakers with a much broader audience, and for that I am truly thankful. I'm grateful for the amazing and talented group of speakers that you will hear from over the next 3 days for giving us some of their time. And I also want to thank LearnSignal, who has partnered with us this year, allowing us to add some additional aspects, including the Arabic translation, which enhances the accessibility of the event. So without further ado, let me pass over to Alan Johnson, President of the IFAC Board, for his opening reflections for this 2022 IFAC EdExchange Summit. Thank you, Alan.
Thank you very much, Helen, and good afternoon, good morning, and good evening to everyone. I would welcome everyone to the 2022 IFAC EdExchange, the Future of Technology in Accounting Summit. I would say at the outset that I'm delighted IFAC is holding this summit this week. So I'd like to thank IFAC management, our CEO, Kevin Dancy, Helen Partridge, Megan Hartman, Karen Sherrill, and other IFAC staff, together with Anne-Marie Vitale, who is the chair of our international panel on accountancy education. And of course, all of the speakers and our sponsor, LearnSignal, for putting together this exciting program. Shortly, I will outline the program for our summit before turning to the topics on the agenda for today's presenters. To begin, I'll offer a few thoughts on what brings us together today. The pandemic, now in its third year, sped up the pace of technological change. The World Economic Forum Future of Jobs Report 2020 confirms what we already know. The pace of technology adoption is expected to remain unabated and may accelerate in some areas. By 2025, 85 million jobs may be displaced by a shift in the division of labor between humans and machines. And that compares to a predicted 75 million displaced jobs from the 2018 edition of the report. So in just 2 years, they've increased that number by 10 million. It is important to note that this is not a prediction of a shrinking world economy, because the WEF report also predicts 97 million emerging roles that are more adapted to the new division of labor between humans, machines, and algorithms. All of this has profound implications for the future of work in our profession. Automation and technology will continue to drive changes in business models across the financial reporting ecosystem. The WEF's 2025 predictions show accounting, bookkeeping, and payroll roles, as well as accountants and auditors, are all in the top five of the declining roles, at least as we know these roles today. To understand the behaviors and competences successful in our profession, we need to understand and predict demand. We can take the WEF predictions for insight here as well. Among the top emerging jobs are data analysts and scientists, big data specialists, process automation specialists, digital transformation specialists, and information security specialists. These trends could eliminate certain accounting and finance-related positions. But I will stress that change will mainly take the form of greater integration of people, processes, and technology into newly defined accounting careers. But we cannot afford to wait to respond to demand. We need to anticipate it. The WEF data gives some insight about the skills and competencies that will be integral to our future success. Among the top skills that employers see as rising in prominence through 2025 are critical thinking and analysis, problem solving, and skills in self-management, such as active learning, resilience, stress tolerance, and flexibility. This is nothing new for our profession, of course, and our strength in these areas will carry over into the future. In the pandemic, many of us have seen accountants doing our work differently, most visibly by using digital tools. This has been an evolution of the accountancy profession. But in the years to come, we will see accountants doing different things entirely. And this change will be a revolution for our profession. It is not an option for us to keep doing the same things. The digital revolution is how we will meet these challenges and also identify new opportunities for us to use our foundational skills in the areas we are not typically known for. Now, it is one thing to say we must learn all of these new skills and competences and continue to evolve our skill set. But to do so, we need also to make sure that there are sufficient resources for existing and aspiring professional accountants and those that educate them. It is essential that we foster collaboration between our stakeholders in our profession, including our professional accountancy organizations, employers, academics, and students, to harness all of these relationships to the benefit of everyone. Collaboration will allow us as a profession to acquire skills and competences and new knowledge more quickly. It will also allow us to respond with greater agility to challenges and opportunities that we do not yet see coming. As I mentioned earlier, the pace of change continues to accelerate, and such collaboration will become only more important. So in conclusion, I wish to add that in our roles as professional accountants, and indeed as citizens, we must always act out of compassion, because the public interest is not an abstraction. It is a means to guarantee that ordinary people can expect to be safe and healthy, to have access to a good education, and find good jobs. Our profession plays a vital and critical role in building and maintaining the institutions and organizations in both the public and in the private sectors that will make all of this possible. It is our duty as professionals to maintain and enhance our skill set as necessary to remain relevant in our roles. IFAC has dedicated this summit, our third annual virtual summit, to help professional accountants and the professional accountancy organizations that support them to explore further the way technology has and is expected to impact the accounting profession. Over these 3 days, we will cover many of the necessary complements to the traditional concept of accountancy education and training. We will hear from speakers with global expertise in technology about the skills and competences needed to be successful in this new era, and some of the risks and opportunities that we all face. The breadth of stakeholders represented by our participants is an essential element of a productive, comprehensive, and global exchange of ideas. We will hear about some of the new technologies we should be engaging in our work and our learning. We will hear case studies of organizations we have integrated, who have integrated technology, and what we should be considering in the world of digital currencies. Our panel discussions will consider the technology skills and competences needed, how to learn them, the impact on audit, and the impact on integrity. Each of the 3 days of our summit will take on a different theme. Day one covers the future. Day two covers skills and competences needed, and day three covers risks and opportunities. In addition, in recognition of the Global Ethics Day, on day three, which is October the 19th, we will hear a conversation with members of the International Ethics Standards Board for Accountants on this year's theme, Ethics Empowered. Now, let me turn to our session today on the demand for organizations to act. It is my pleasure to briefly introduce today's speakers. Ben Elder, who is the Global Head of Strategic Partnerships at Meta, will help us see some of the possibilities the metaverse offers. Paul Guthew, the EY Global Assurance Innovation and Emerging Technology Partner, and Aaron Misra, the EY Audit Senior Manager, who will discuss some of the current trends in technology and their impact to professional accountants globally. Dr. Robert Kay, who is the co-founder and executive director of Incept Labs, and Philomena Leung, Director of Education at the Institute of Public Accountants, will both share some research findings on how technology is impacting our continuous learning mindset. And to conclude the day, Cameron Carr, FinTech Advisor to IOSCO, and Sanjay Urugani, the CEO of Standard Chartered Bank of Uganda, who is also the chair of the Professional Accountants in Business and Public Sector Advisory Group of IFAC, will discuss the future of FinTech. This year, keynotes and sessions will include live interpretation, as has already been said by Helen, in Arabic, French, Russian, and Spanish. Please note that the video recordings for sessions in each of these languages and in English will be available on the IFAC website following this event. I wish you all a very successful summit, a summit that offers an opportunity to share with and learn from each other. Thank you for giving so much of your valuable time over the next 3 days. The profession's ability to adapt constantly to meet the needs of the world and the public interest we support are the reasons that I came into this profession 40 years ago, and certainly the reason that I've stayed. With that, I will now hand over to Ben to begin our program. Thank you, Ben.
Hi, everyone. I'm thrilled to be joining you today. My name is Ben Elder, and I lead Global Strategic Partnerships at Meta in our Reality Labs B2B commercial team. We help businesses to unlock the potential of the metaverse, which is what I'm here to talk to you about today. In the last generation, we have witnessed radical shifts and changes in how we connect, learn, work, and shop. This has happened through the evolution of our technology. Over the last few decades, technology has removed the barriers to connection and expression. It has democratized the ability to connect with each other anywhere, anytime, and distance and cost have become less and less of a barrier. And the metaverse is the next step in technology evolution. The devices that will take us there represent the next evolution of computing, one that's much more immersive and integrated into your life. The platforms and experiences that make up the metaverse will take what we love about today's internet, the connections and experiences that are impossible in the physical world, and make them so much better. What we believe is that the metaverse will be around us. Once you tune in to any of the apps or devices, you are connected to it and all others who have also tuned in. Thus far, our relationship with the internet has been looking at it, with most interactions flat and framed and fixed, almost always brokered by a screen. But our belief is that from now on, you will be inside of it. The possibilities of what the internet is literally laid out at your feet, aided by virtual reality headsets. In the metaverse, you and each of us can be represented by and experience an avatar, a virtual world you can call home, shop for your virtual identities, as well as those in the physical world, play games and watch movies with your friends, the exploration of distant fantasy worlds. And the metaverse is not a copy of the physical world. Its 3D landscapes, games, and worlds will all bend and move around you. Because the metaverse and all of the experiences within it don't have to conform to the same structure of time, space, and physics that the physical world does. This new way of experiencing content, building these experiences, and owning the choices of what we see and do can lead to some of the richest and most creative spaces for connection and opportunity. Through entertainment, education, travel, commerce, and identity, we get to build and promote inclusive worlds, stories, and experiences that elevate minds and change perception. This is both our opportunity and our responsibility. Now we've talked about it, but let's define the metaverse. The metaverse is a set of digital, interconnected experiences that can be accessed by any device, anywhere, with anyone. And we believe you will be able to access those experiences from many devices with a different level of definition, some that exist today and others that will exist in the future. Not unlike what came before, the internet and desktop computers, the app store with mobile devices, accessing the metaverse through VR devices will take some getting used to. And the way we present in these worlds, our avatars, will be synonymous with our digital identities and will power meaningful experiences across our platforms and beyond. On June 17th, we announced the launch of Avatar Store, which allows you to customize your avatar with items like clothing and accessories. In the future, creators and brands will push the boundaries of digital clothing and shopping, and people will have a new canvas to share who they are. Avatar commerce is an early bet to build a bridge in the metaverse, seed an economy, and establish digital ownership and identity. We'll make the time we spend online better and more meaningful by connecting our physical worlds to the augmented and virtual worlds through the metaverse. And it can enable richer social connection and provide a unique sense of presence, even when we're far from each other. The metaverse will help you feel more present with the world around you, whether that's the physical world or the virtual world. We will be able to interact with content, games, and indeed work through our bodies and our senses, not just keyboards and touchscreens. We are seeing the start of this today with controller-free experiences like the one found on Meta's Quest devices. And it's not just social presence that will evolve. Professional presence will too. Imagine being able to work from anywhere with anyone, but still feeling like you're together. As boundaries such as geography and access fade away, you could have your dream job and live anywhere you like. This is already to a degree possible today. Every week, for example, at least one of my team meetings take place in Meta workrooms in the metaverse, where I interact with colleagues in a place that time zone and geography have no meaning and the distractions from mobile phones do not exist. From our point of view, the metaverse can enable better remote experiences than anything that exists today, and we will dedicate our energy to helping achieve its potential. And that potential is driven by presence. And that feeling is made possible thanks to holograms, avatars, and other embodied forms of presence. You will be able to communicate with all the subtle cues you use in the physical world, such as hand gestures, eye contact, and expressions with others. So, why does all this matter? We believe the content that people want to interact with and share is changing. Over time, there's a clear trend that technology enables people to share richer content with increasing frequency. 5 years ago, for example, most of what people shared on Facebook was text and images. Now it's video. After that, immersive content like VR or AR. This is an opportunity and challenge for all businesses. If people have more tools for engaging and expression, we should create more useful experiences for them to engage with. So we're evolving as a company too. Last year, for example, we changed our company name from Facebook to Meta, reflecting our past investments in communities, creators, and commerce tools, only to help bridge our vision for the future. And our foundational apps, products, and services will serve as a crucial part of the metaverse ecosystem. Our role in this journey is to help accelerate the development of the fundamental technologies, platforms, and creative tools that will bring the metaverse to life, and to weave these technologies together and through our social media apps. You'll see future investments in hardware and software that unlock the potential to defy distance and can provide new opportunities for how people can express themselves and do things together. But it's not just an evolution of content and sharing, it's also about the evolution of community, of storytelling, and of commerce. Let's talk about commerce for a minute. Many years ago, Facebook dabbled in virtual goods. We had an online marketplace where people could buy virtual gifts for their friends and deliver them via the Facebook wall. Virtual commerce is not totally unfamiliar to consumers. Games like Farmville or Animal Crossing relied on sales of virtual objects to maintain gameplay, and consoles like Xbox and PlayStation have for a long time provided additions to various games through the purchase of financial add-ons. And we've proven that virtual connections to physical goods lead to physical sales, as seen on Facebook Marketplace. In the metaverse, we will have the need for both physical and virtual commerce and ways to connect virtual items to the physical world. Investments from us in the future might look like taking your physical or online shop and turning it into a virtual space in the metaverse for people to experience your products and brand just as they would physically in a shop, or car dealers finding new customers if they were to offer virtual test drives in the metaverse that are scheduled on Messenger or WhatsApp. Creators and businesses will be able to leverage new tools to earn income, and people can support their favorite creators with brands by purchasing digital collectibles, art, images and videos, music or trading cards, such as tokens, otherwise known as NFTs, or outfits to personalize their avatars. Our roadmap over the next decade is ambitious because we believe in this future. We will have virtual worlds, we will have digital overlays on top of physical locations, we will have mixed reality experiences that bring the two together, and we will have a technical foundation underpinning it all. But none of this exists today. It just doesn't. So there is not much to do right now other than study, read, and learn. Start by asking yourself and your clients the right questions. What should you be investing in? The necessary tech, the creative know-how? Are your clients acing the basics now when it comes to the future? Read about the metaverse and encourage your clients to read about the metaverse and stay up to date with the latest trends and initiatives. Look for examples of companies that are already building new economies through AR and VR, many of which you will find published on our website. The metaverse cannot be built by a single company, and we recognize this. But our roadmap over the next decade is ambitious because we believe in this future. It will take all of us to build the bridges to the metaverse together, and we're looking forward to partnering with all of you on this journey. Thank you.
Many thanks and to Ben, and he'll be joining us in a minute. But before we get to that, can I please ask all participants to mute their microphones? With the translations, we can't unfortunately just mute everybody, and it's making it very difficult for our interpreters to make sure they're getting you the information you need. So kindly keep your microphones off and ask any questions you have in the Slido. Thank you. And thank you to the patience of our interpreters who are doing a wonderful job. So Ben, let me turn to you if I may. And thanks again so much for joining us. The metaverse is such this like concept that many people struggle to get their heads around. And for a client service industry such as the accounting profession, and we deal with internal, external clients, how do you imagine the metaverse changing what we do?
Well, firstly, thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure to be here with you. Potentially in a number of different ways, the applications of the metaverse that we're seeing initially are around education and skills development. The concept of the metaverse is so new that if you type it into Google, a lot of the articles that come up first are explaining what the metaverse is very much so. But I think what we're seeing already is applications across multiple different industries where people are taking advantage of the technology to educate and to learn. For example, whilst this is out of industry, we're seeing hotel chains design a lifelike replica of their facilities in the metaverse to have people learn how to use and how to get around the hotel and use their systems and tools before they even start on their first day in their job. So I think beyond just the ability to have virtual meetings and bring you closer to your client and replicate that sense of personal being is the ability to learn and to connect with organizations and technologies in a number of different ways.
Fantastic, thanks. It's funny you say out of industry. I never think of anything being out of industry because all of our clients are in so many different industries. It's helpful to understand how other industries are using the technologies that you mentioned. One of the questions from the audience talks about many countries have a less developed IT infrastructure impacting the take up on cutting edge technology. How do you think some of those, or what would your recommendation be for some of those countries that need to develop the infrastructure for something like the metaverse?
I think the metaverse, we're talking about it as being like the next platform of computing. And unfortunately, in the past, where we've seen other computing platforms, I think probably most notably public cloud has in the past been a bit of a barrier to entry when it comes to connectivity and accessibility. I think innovation always finds a way. The metaverse, I think it's important to say, and Alan alluded to this in his opening remarks, whilst I think generally across the world, we're confident this is going to be the next important platform of computing, it is important to say that it is something that is still fundamentally very, very new. Organizations are only just starting to make their initial investments in various different metaverse technologies and started to kind of dip their toes in the water, as it were. So I think that as the metaverse starts to become more adopted widely and we start to hear more and more examples of successful use cases, I think that there'll be the opportunity for all to benefit from what can come from the metaverse. And as I said, I think that there are parallels to other initiatives in the past, and public cloud is certainly one that we look at, which, you know, took off gradually over time and is now widely embraced in some industries and some verticals. So I think the demand and the benefits of the metaverse will help with that.
Brilliant. What do you see as the biggest challenge to an organization taking on educational development, or even like just the work meetings you're talking about in their journey?
Again, I think Alan alluded to this at the start, whether knowingly or unknowingly. I think what the biggest single challenge right now is the lack of perception of available skills. You know, for example, I referred to public cloud, but again, could use cybersecurity as an example. If you think about other computing initiatives and you needed to find a particular resource or an expert in a technology, you could go onto LinkedIn pretty quickly, or generally within your contact list or network, you could find someone that has a relevant level of expertise. And if you're working with a larger organization, often they're able to go and hire someone or bring in someone that's got capability. I think the initial challenge with the metaverse is, you know, as we're talking about today, it's still very, very early. And, you know, if you think about, you know, do I know someone in my personal network, or could I go and recruit someone easily that brings in a set of skills or experience? the metaverse obviously has multiple different applications, blockchain and crypto, AR and VR. And as such, because these technologies are still relatively new and not widely adopted, that the skills don't exist in market. So what that means for an organization that's looking to start having a focus on the metaverse themselves is they're going to need to learn some of these skills themselves. And that can often be a challenge because the priorities and demands of your business don't go away. So you often have to invest time, make time and find time to build those expertise. And that's why I think probably one of the most important things a company can do right now is to read and to learn and start building that bank of experience in your own organization, because it will be one of the most valuable commodities that you'll have.
To ask you a personal question, how long did it take you to get the skills necessary for the metaverse, recognizing you're like the top level, but like how long would it take somebody to learn that, do you think?
I think it depends on what you're asking. I think if how long does it take to learn to be able to competently put on a VR headset and start a meeting and invite others to meeting? I'm blessed in an environment where there are others with skills that can talk you through that and coach you how to do it. But it's not as scary and it's not as difficult as you would think. Once you get used to the fact that you're wearing a headset, for example, and you've got these handheld devices as opposed to a keyboard or a mouse, or some that have voice commands, and you are able to get over the experience of feeling like you're in a different environment as opposed to your physical location. Setting up a meeting room is just as easy as it is to set up a Zoom meeting room, for example. So I think that as human beings, we naturally reject in our brains things that are new because they can be difficult to learn. Many will be able to reflect on a personal experience of launching a new tool or system and initially feeling a bit negative about it, like, oh, here's another platform that I have to learn how to use. And it really is very similar with the metaverse, and I'm referring specifically to using AR or VR for a moment. But once you put on the device and pluck up that courage to try the new technology, it really doesn't take too long at all. And certainly from my perspective now, having team meetings in the metaverse, it's the norm because I've done it so many times.
That makes sense. How long would it take to produce a course, out of curiosity? Do you have any sense? Have you had any experience with like maybe a one-day course?
Meta, we've been running workshops and we've been providing demos of headsets and meetings for clients in some of our offices globally for quite a few months now. At one of our recent events last week, we gave everyone like a 30-minute kind of crash course in how to set up a meeting, how to create an avatar, how to set up your account. So it doesn't really take that much time at all to look at the basics. But obviously, I'm referring to only one aspect of the metaverse, and there are other applications as well. So I'd encourage that rather than thinking about how much time do I need to invest, read, research, think about what applications of the metaverse are going to be most relevant to your business. Because it's obvious, of course, that not all of them potentially will be, depending on the clients that you're working with or your own personal circumstance. I would say that putting on a headset, it doesn't take too long. And if you wanted to create a course or start some learning or build some kind of service there, there's lots of resources out there, but it really doesn't take too long to show someone how to put a headset on and get into a meeting.
That makes sense. And I'm assuming there's also some economies of scale. So, I mean, once you've kind of built a course in the metaverse, there's an element of you can reuse it as opposed to trying to find the same room over again, the same instructors. Is that true or maybe not so much?
Yeah, absolutely. I think you mentioned economies of scale. I think that's like the once someone has got a bank of experience, that scales pretty fast, right? Like one person from their own experience is able to talk to someone and show someone else how to do something. I wouldn't say we're all naturally driving instructors just because we know how to drive a car, but you can certainly tell someone how to turn on an ignition and what the pedals do, for example. So I think every experience, every bit of knowledge that you as an individual and talking to the participants of the session, everything that you read and everything you learn, that becomes valuable because that's your knowledge and experience that you can pass on. I think that the biggest value is the learning that each individual takes. And there's lots and lots of content and resources out there. I mentioned just having metaverse into Google, you'll find that every single day there's more and more content available for people to share and use and learn.
Brilliant. Thank you. One question that came through was, do you have any platforms or sites that provide metaverse services for education?
So specifically for education, no. But if you take a look at the Meta website after our Connect event last week, we've just relaunched it. There's lots and lots of content on there now around our approach to the metaverse and our applications. And just as I said at the end of the presentation there, Meta's perspective on the metaverse is only one. Whilst we've kind of taken the approach that we're all in and have renamed our company last year to Meta, we're very much aware that we're not the only company that will be responsible for building this platform, and many others will be along the journey with us. But our website has vast amounts of resources on the devices themselves that you can use to get started. And I would certainly recommend checking out our blog post. There's lots of content on there, which is written by authors both inside and outside of Meta, which is very useful to be able to understand in the applications of the technologies.
Fantastic. Thank you. So thinking about bringing everybody in, or a number of stakeholders in, do you ever get a sense that the metaverse will be regulated worldwide?
I think that's probably a bit above my pay grade to be able to provide a firm opinion of that. But I think that, you know, Meta as an organization, it's important that it's not just us that are building and designing the metaverse, as I said. So I think that there needs to be protection and safety, as there is in all computing platforms for people. But I think that can be the extent of my answer.
Noted. Thank you. So just in terms of like thinking about next steps for the individual, what first steps would you recommend an individual take to start their journey? Is it getting the VR headset? Is it, you know, going onto your website, as you mentioned? What's the first steps?
I think read. I would follow the first steps that I think many organizations take, which is to use whatever resources you have, whether it's the technology pages in your local newspapers or whether you go online. Start to research the metaverse and any notes that you're able to take from the presentation today, and any insights on some of the technologies that are coming. Just read and learn. There's plenty of books that you can find in your local bookstore as well around technologies. One that I would recommend is Reality Check by Jeremy Dalton, which is a really good essay, if you will, on the applications for immersive technologies in the workplace. So that would be a great recommendation to start there, is to pick up a book or to read online. Of course, at some point, taking the next step is going to be to purchase something, finding a use case, talking to clients and find out if others are in the same situation. And of course, yeah, picking up a headset and getting into the metaverse and experiencing it for yourself, because that's one way to determine what applications are going to be relevant to you and to your business.
Great, thank you. And I guess one last question, if I may, and it came through on it's one question I have and also from the audience. So the question from the audience was, great technology normally fills a need or a gap. What need or gap does the metaverse solve, right? And my question was, what are the benefits of interacting in the metaverse versus interacting in person?
Yeah, absolutely. I can speak from personal experience in this regard. And one of the things that I find having a virtual team meeting with my colleagues, the group that I work in, which is an hour every single week, I find myself far more immersed in that experience than I do if it's a virtual Zoom meeting. And that's not to say anything against Zoom, but how many people, for example, that might be watching this presentation for now also have their mobile phone in their hand and might be kind of multitasking and doing something at the same time? When you're having a meeting in the metaverse, there are no distractions from mobile phones. There are no distractions from other things that happen around you, even in the office. If you might see someone walk past that you think, oh, I might need to go have a coffee or catch up with them later, I haven't seen them before. When you've got the headset on and you're engaging with everyone in the room, you're locked in and you're there and you're far more participative because you're experiencing what's happening around you without distractions, but in a way that feels consistently familiar. Even though people look a bit different because you're represented by an avatar, it gives you that personal sense of connection without the distractions. So that would be just my view on the question.
It's kind of a forced focus tool. I like it.
Need that for, I wouldn't say the word forced, but it definitely doesn't focus. If you're in the metaverse, you're in the metaverse.
Wonderful. Thank you. Any last reflections in terms of, I guess, where should the accounting profession take the metaverse next?
In terms of what the applications of the metaverse will be specifically for the profession, I think that's still to be determined, as it is for many, many other industries, of course, as well. But I think the metaverse is exciting, and I would encourage others to read, to learn, as I've said several times. We're still very new on this journey, all of us collectively, and I think there's a lot of exciting possibilities ahead. But the more that you read, the more that you learn now, the better position you'll be in future if an opportunity does present itself, which could be exciting for you as an organization. So I would definitely say, if you, however you organize yourself, keep a tab open on your computer and continue to follow the industry news. Meta had our Connect event last week, which you can find online on our website. I would encourage those that are interested in hearing more from Meta's perspective to go back and watch that.
Wonderful. Thank you. Well, thank you so much again, Ben, for joining us. I appreciate your time. Meta Connect was a good event, so congratulations on that. And thank you again.
Thank you so much.
The possibilities of where the metaverse could take us in education development and in our daily work is really truly boundless, I think. And who knows, maybe at some point in the future, we could be holding part of this summit there. Hopefully it's easier to mute some of the microphones, but we'll see. Before I turn to our next speakers, if you could again turn to your Slido screens, either on your computer or on your second device, I do have a couple of questions to see if your imagination and your creativity is starting to kick in. The first question is, do you see yourself possibly using the metaverse for work or for learning in the next 5 years? The second question, and I saw this coming through, which will come up in a minute, but around the attractiveness, right? And so my question here is, do you see using the metaverse in a professional setting as being something that maybe attracts new talent to the accounting profession in the next 5 years? So while you're just answering those, I ask that second question again, because in part, I do fear that we are a declining profession. We're known predominantly for what we've always provided for the past 100 years, and we've always provided that with quality and integrity. As I envision the work for IFAC Accounting Education in the next couple of years, I want to explore further, how do we evolve that narrative to draw in the new talent? How do we explain what we can do, what the possibilities are, what the capabilities we have, and something we can deliver with the same quality and integrity that we already know for delivering? So if I look at the Slido polls, I think it looks very clearly a yes, yes. Okay, make sure that you can go to Slido, please, to register the votes for those questions. So again, you should see one question still up around does the metaverse possibly attract new talent in the future? So I think 83% say yes. So that sounds like a resounding yes that I should be thinking about how to think about metaverse and attracting new talent. So next, we will hear from Paul Goodhue and Arun Misra as we explore some of the other technologies that are available to us as professional accountants and things we should be leveraging in our work and in our development. Paul Goodhue is EY's Global Assurance and Innovation and Emerging Technology Leader. And in this role, Paul is at the forefront of innovation for EY Assurance Services and leads EY's assurance investments across artificial intelligence, blockchain, and virtual collaboration technologies. Arun Misra works closely with Paul in EY's Assurance Technology Transformation Program. He is a client-serving senior manager with significant digital audit experience and has served as a digital account leader for a large multinational audit engagement, coordinating the entire digital audit strategy for the global audit. Welcome, Paul. Welcome, Arun. Thank you so much for joining us here today.
Thank you very much, Helen, and hello to the whole group. Really pleased to be here with you today and really excited to talk about how the audit profession is changing through automation and through artificial intelligence, and really just to share a bit about the digital transformation that we're going through here at EY. As you said, quick introduction, Paul Goodhue, I'm a partner with EY's assurance organization based out of London in the UK. And I'm really, what my role means is I get to spend a lot of time with our teams and our clients, really understanding their requirements and matching those requirements up to the technology that we know is on the horizon that we can grasp hold of and use to develop the next generation of technology-enabled services here at EY, but also to transform the experience for our clients and for our professionals. So really excited to be with you. We have Arun here as well. Maybe Arun, you just want to give a little bit more context as to your role?
Yeah, absolutely. I think Helen did a great job of capturing my enthusiasm for technology and audit. But I am a client-serving senior manager in the audit profession, and I'm currently serving a multi-year assignment in Tokyo. So if you ever wonder if there's still possibilities of floating around the world in Big Four, that's certainly the case.
Brilliant. And so today, really, what we wanted to cover is a couple of things to talk about automation and technology and some of the trends that we've seen over the past few years and where we see that those trends evolving. We'll share a little bit with you about our own technology transformation at EY, something that we're really proud of and excited about where we're going next. But also talk about how this changes the experience for professionals in the industry, right? There's a lot of talk about what this means for the future of the profession in terms of skills and capabilities required. So we really wanted to dive into that with the team today. And then also just talking about where we see directionally things going from an intelligent automation and AI perspective. We're really excited about that. Arun and I love the topic. So looking forward to talking about that with you. And then finally on Q&A side, I know there's an opportunity for people to add questions in, and Helen and team will facilitate those. So looking forward to taking some of your questions as we go through. But maybe if we move on to the next slide, really just to start talking just in terms of the automation and technology trends we've seen over the past few years. So if I think back, right, even over the sort of the last 15, 20 years, we've seen a technology revolution taking place in the world around us. But also that's been a transformation that's really impacted the audit and the accounting professions. Right, we've seen that significant digital transformation over time, where we've moved from what might be considered the traditional audit to what we at EY called the digital audit. And really, this is a change that has impacted the audit firms, but also the companies that audit firms serve. To give you a flavor of that, so for us, under the traditional audit approach, we had clients who would have gone and developed a portfolio of ERP and accounting systems to help run their business. And they would have implemented internal control systems, but had some level of IT enablement to them. At the same time, auditors were utilizing paper and spreadsheet-based approaches, random sampling techniques, and of course, conducting controls and IT-based audits. So what's changed as part of the digital audit approach? Well, we've seen companies evolve over recent years with much more increased centralization of processes, systems, controls, often enabled by a harmonization of their ERP portfolio under a single or a limited number of systems, often based in the cloud as well. And as those companies have been able to bring that data together, they've really been able to leverage the power of data as business intelligence to help inform the decisions that they make, but also to use data analytics for use cases such as supporting their internal control system. From an audit perspective, right, we've seen the audit firms make similar transformational investments in technology, particularly over the last 5 to 7 years, where the firms have been developing connected audit technology platforms, which help us do things like project manage and deliver the audit. And with this has come the automation of routine and repetitive tasks, as well as developing technology to support with the extraction and the analysis of entire populations of client data from their own ERP systems. And we use this information to support our ability to gather audit evidence. But like, why is this even important? Well, it facilitates our ability to do a few things, right? Number one, to realize an enhanced experience for the companies that our audit team serve. We've improved information flows between auditor and the client, easier techniques to share data and tasks and queries, and really ultimately to provide better insights as we deliver our audits. Number two, yeah, it supports our commitment to deliver high quality audits, right? With technology helping with timely and accurate project management, as well as through the ability to analyze those full populations of data that I talked about, and ultimately using that data to guide our professionals on where to look. And number three, it creates a better experience for the audit professional, working with technology on a day-to-day basis, supporting our ability to work internationally, remotely, and in hybrid environments. And I mean, that's just been so critical over the last few years during the pandemic. And then where I look like in the yellow box, where do we go next? Our vision of the future is really based on three dimensions. Number one, the scope and the context of the audit is going to evolve. And it's really based around the topic of trust. So today, you know, historically audit services typically linked to financials and then controls-based audits. But we see a huge shift forward as we think about the concept of using non-financial data as part of our audit work, but also how our reporting requirements are evolving related to the ESG and sustainability agenda. So the work we do is changing. But number two, the data and the technology is rapidly moving forwards. So with companies and audit firms investing in new platforms, new systems and data, we recognize that there's a huge potential to drive the next generation of automation and AI using those technologies and using that information as this universe of data explodes. And then the third thing is the skills and the experience, right, that I've talked about. We do not see technology as replacing people. We see the future for our talented professionals as working hand in hand with the technology and developing a broader set of competencies as the scope of the audit evolves. You know, this ultimately is going to require people to adopt new skills and new experiences and new capabilities. And that's what I'm really excited about as we see the future of our profession. So now I want to hand over to Arun to give some real insight into what EY has actually been doing in this space.
Yeah, well said, Paul, with all of that. And it's funny, I was speaking with some university students just today. And one of the things I did is I didn't call it the traditional audit. I called it the legacy audit. And that's because it's just one I haven't done in a few years now. So it's very much the digital audit is the now. So onto this slide that's talking about our technology today. And I'm very much the right person to be talking to you about this just because I'm using this technology every day. I'm what we write in the tech, they call it the daily active user, including Canvas, this one right here in the first bullet. And it says 100% coverage of EY Canvas Global Audit Platform. And let me put that into context. So we are a collection of member firms, but all of those member firms understand the value of our audit platform and how globally cohesive it is. As Helen laid out at the start, I've worked on a multinational engagement. It's been extremely powerful having all the component teams related to my group audit all on the same technology platform because it's just allowed us to propel forward in that way. But also being on that same platform allows us to embed additional capabilities. And that's where the key word of this presentation comes in, which is automations. We have those hosted straight in the platform for ease of access and direct connection to sort of our audit workflows. And I like to think of that as we're automating all the way to the work papers. And so we don't even have those little last manual steps just to get it into the file that we used to have earlier in my career. Now, the next couple talk about EY and our client users, which is obviously a hefty amount of users given how large we are as a firm and in our client footprint. But I think what's noteworthy in this is this makes us one of the largest B2B platforms in the world. And that's astounding to even think about that we're connecting that many users. It's sort of exponential, the number of people that touch the audit on both sides. So then into automation here on the right, and I think that's definitely what you want to hear about here. And we have a new and ever expanding sort of set of automation capabilities. Paul mentioned the labor intensive repetitive tasks. I think what has been incredibly powerful for us has been how we've set up our automation to be scalable, starting with a big project that we had a few years back. And what that's allowed us to be is to have more activations than engagements even last year. So this pragmatic approach to automation gives us a little bit of a wider reach than a typical RPA might. And it winds up having us with every audit using at least more than one automation solution in their service delivery. And another noteworthy thing about the automation is it's client facing with certain automated workflows and augmented expertise sort of embedded to help save clients time. I think about some of our automations relate to some things such as gap disclosure compliance and the confirmation process. Those things in our profession obviously tend to involve the client, but the client actually gets to use our technology while working with those automations. And that gives us a sense of control over the whole process. On the right side here, analyzing, I can't skip over that. We also have some very mature process automation, in some cases, even data virtualization that puts data into the hands of our professionals quicker. And I think that's one thing that can be overlooked is how the speed of delivery of analysis, sort of automation in pursuit of analytics, really helps drive client value, because what we end up using data end to end in the audit before and after the books close. And that sort of external and independent insight that comes from that helps our clients, interestingly enough, get to know themselves better, because the types of questions we ask, the types of insights we add beyond the audit, that sort of increases our value proposition of what is traditionally a compliance perceived business. And of course, AI, we have mentioned a couple of times on this slide, and that appears across our automation and our analytics. I try to think of it as two categories here. There's things like machine learning influencing behaviors, whether it be our risk assessment, our order of operations, our prioritization, or even the very nature of the procedures we perform. Sort of treating the audit like a chess match, if you will, like with all the infinite different directions that can be taken to get to the result. And as well as AI assessing transactions, finding those outliers and those anomalies across the full breadth of client data. Paul alluded to the full breadth of data just earlier, and having those solutions there and augmenting that expertise so that we get to those answers faster certainly helps us, and it certainly helps our clients as well with that timeliness. All right, with that, I am going to turn it back over to you, Paul, to talk a little bit about the talent experience.
Yeah, thank you, Arun. So for me, really, what I think about, right, all of this technology transformation, whether it's at the strategic level or what we've specifically done at EY, like the question always comes back to, well, what does it actually mean for our people? And when I think about it, I really want to come back to this concept of the audit professional and the technology working hand in hand. This concept of a digital audit has meant that we've significantly had to evolve our organization and our talent model over the last few years just to keep up with the technology. If I think about those pillars, right, that Arun just highlighted, this concept of connecting, of analyzing, automating, and ultimately driving value, it's not just describing the technology at work, but it's also describing what our people are doing. So our people are connecting, right? They're connecting with one another, and they're connecting with our clients through our cloud-based audit platform, Canvas. They're getting and sharing information with the client via the portal, exchanging status updates, even, you know, discussing with the IT department how to get access securely to the client's data and how to use that information. On the analyzing side, our teams are reviewing general ledger and subledger data, right? You saw on a previous slide, we processed over 680 billion lines of journal entry data last year, right? As well as other data types such as process data and blockchain data, which requires specialist capabilities and techniques to be able to understand this information. And it requires specialist tools and technology to be able to process this data. So again, right, this concept of professional and machine working hand in hand. On the automation side, yep. Great. The great news is our people have less manual and repetitive tasks to do, whether it's things like confirmations, right, or completing checklists. We're able to support our people through automation, and it means that our people are spending less time on those tasks, much more time on areas requiring their professional judgment and their professional skepticism. But also our people are building technology, right? They're creating locally developed automation capabilities and data analyzers for specific sectors or specific requirements. And so it's really changed the dimension of how our people work, right? It's not just about doing the audit work, but a lot of our people have become passionate and deeply involved in technology and building technology to solve problems. And ultimately, it's all about driving value. And that's meant that for our people, you know, we've elevated people into the role of digital account leaders on our highest priority accounts, right, where we have our people working day to day with their counterparts on the client side to get the data, to understand the information, and to establish technology roadmaps over the coming years, which marries up with what our clients are doing as our clients invest in their own technology. We run client innovation sessions on an annual basis, if not even more frequently than that, engaging directly with the client's accounting and finance team on that technology roadmap I talked about. And it's really required us to elevate people's roles and responsibilities, not just on areas requiring that deeper judgment and skepticism, but people have established as part of an overall digital network across our business to drive activation and change management at scale. So it's really forced us to do a couple of things differently, and maybe just give you a flavor of what some of those specifics are. Like, we've launched a training program, including our digital badges in topics like data visualization and artificial intelligence, which are available to every EY assurance professional globally to help them stay at the forefront of the latest emerging technologies, both from a client impact, but also from an audit impact perspective. We have technology-focused MBAs offered to our people today, where we provide accredited corporate MBAs in technology and business analytics linked directly to that badges program. And we've had to completely rethink our career framework. We've worked to develop a technology-specific framework for professionals who are looking to forge a path on professions like advanced digital skills and proficiencies, product management, user experience. And so we have a number of people who have evolved their roles, not just from being a pure client service professional working to deliver audit services, but actually being part of our technology team, building the next generation of technology. And we see that trend increasing more and more over time as we continue to invest in the next generation of tech. So maybe, Arun, you could talk about what's next and what's over the horizon in terms of new technologies.
Yeah, for sure. How gracious of our innovation and emerging technology leader to hand off the responsibility of talking about next and beyond. But though, first alluding to one thing you said there, it is about, I think one thing I recalled when listening to you speak just now was about how when I started with this firm, the thing that attracted me here was the people. And there was a presentation I did to some university students not too long ago. And I had a younger team member there with us, and they asked both of us that question. And my younger team member answered, it was the technology. And if there's one thing we know for sure is that younger professionals want to work with cutting edge technology. And that is something we're certainly seeing in not just the day to day, but the every day and the every moment. Here on the next and the beyond, in case you missed it, we announced earlier this year a US $1 billion investment in next generation assurance technology platform over the coming handful of years. And we acknowledge that's us responding rapidly to some changing expectations from regulators, standard setters, and our stakeholders. But really, this is about putting us and taking us from a strong position we're already in and enhancing certain components of this, giving us a broader set of data access with advanced analytics, artificial intelligence. We've only begun that journey. And interestingly here, a highlight on the user experience, because what we realize is that the user experience is what propels us and takes this core of foundation that we have is just gonna make it take off like a rocket ship in terms of our technology. So we spoke about this now column here just a few minutes ago. The next, I did just speak about the user experience, but other things to think about here is how the technology is sort of caught up a bit with certain things like document intelligence and AI user guidance. If you think about just a few years ago, it would have been a lot more expensive to introduce capabilities like this, whether you're in industry or an audit like us or anything. So there's certainly a great capability that with a good foundation set of capabilities we have now to be able to leverage more what's on the market to just really propel us forward. And then transforming our data access model is very interesting. It's like thinking about there's a broad set and a very, Paul talked about the 680 billion lines. There's more than one useful pipeline for that in audit, and there's more than one useful pipeline for that in client value. As we think about the beyond, being fully connected in this intuitive ecosystem, again, alluding back to the user experience, is something we're really focused on because we do think of technology as a really strong tool to have in the tool belt. And I think it's one thing I didn't realize when I came into this profession is that the technology would help increase the depth of questions. I actually need to be a more knowledgeable professional than I think ever before, because the depth of the questions just becomes so much more relevant when you have that much information that quickly. Intelligent profiling and risk response to better support complex audit activities. I think a lot of what investments across us and our peers has been focused on some of the accounts that are very transactionally homogenous or things like this, but you actually see that the technology is putting us in more capable hands of being able to support more complex things, whether it be looking for complex accounting issues within the financials or even taking and finding things in documents, not just reading them or optical character recognition, OCR, things like that, but actually reading and understanding that information. And then, of course, predictive analytics. I think everyone started by looking backwards in audit, but we are more capable than ever before in taking the data that we have, whether externally or internally to the entities that we're auditing, and looking forward with it and being out ahead of the financial information. Anything to add there, Paul?
I think that's fantastic, right? From my point of view, I really think it comes down to having this power of a global platform. And as we move that platform into the cloud, right, and we acquire more and more data, it's not just data from our clients, but it's actually data that we generate, right? We have tens of thousands of professionals doing the same things every single day in that platform, making similar decisions, similar selections, similar choice. And we know that that information is hugely valuable to help us digitize our workflows and ultimately use artificial intelligence to guide people, right? This is what you should be doing. And it's almost like as a professional, when you're sitting there every day, historically, you might have had two or three people either side of you in the office you could get their advice around. Now you've got tens of thousands of people, right? That information can be brought together using artificial intelligence to recommend to you, like, here's what so many other similar auditors did in similar situations. You may not make that same decision. You may have good reason to make a different decision, but at least, right, being able to understand what other people did in similar circumstances. For me, that's really, really exciting, right, as an example of the future where we can go with artificial intelligence, which again, I think of as like an automation example, right? Because it's ultimately about that coexistence of the system and the professional. The professional still making the decision, but guided by the information. So that for me is just a snapshot of where we're going. And I think it's just really exciting for the future of the profession.
Great. Well, there's a couple of great questions that came in. So I'm just going to go ahead and tee them up so we can get in as many as possible. So one of them that came in most recently is, are we developing technology for sustainability reporting and audits in addition to financial statements? So I thought you could take that one, Paul.
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's such a hot topic at the moment. And we're really excited about our investment, that $1 billion investment that Arun talked about, also impacts our ability to develop new sustainability-related technology, right? And at the moment, there are some great examples of what we're doing here at EY, right? Whether it's developing your capabilities to ingest non-financial data, which can be environmental-related data, it could be employee-related data, to conduct things like to provide assurance over the reporting disclosures that our clients make. But we're even going as far as using things like GPS data and satellite imagery. We have a project going on at the moment, really to help us look at different types of information and provide assurance over that information. And for me, it's just really exciting. There's a lot of activity in that space at the moment. And we know that by complementing what we do on the financial side with that non-financial information, we really got that opportunity to use technology to provide a much, much greater lens over our clients' organizations and the reporting that they issue out. So really excited about that.
Yeah, and I can add on to that, Paul, by just saying that there's, of course, these investments we're doing at the center of our global firm that we're going to scale across the entirety of that ESG business. But in addition, even in, I've served a couple multinational clients here where we've done some engagements and reviews over ESG reporting, and we have been able to very flexibly take a lot of our audit approaches and repurpose them for ESG reporting. And I guess I think I've never seen or client contacts that is so engaged with us as when we were telling them things they didn't know about their own ESG data. It's been a very powerful set for us as well there. So there's another good question here is, will the use of technology and tools increase the quality of audits, thereby shifting from audit sampling to enhancing a more enhanced risk-based audit? And I can say on that, like, very much so, audit quality has been increasing. And at the same time, expectations increase. We have this game with whether it be across our peers or with our stakeholders or even our regulators about, you know, the expectations are higher. Also, the visibility is higher. If you think about trends in reporting with key audit matters and things like that, there's an expectation that we do more of these. And I'll say with the example that was put forth here, shifting from audit sampling to a more comprehensive risk-based audit, I've done an entire audit without taking a sample just within the last year. And that's just something I couldn't have even been close to saying some years ago, just because the technology is what made that happen. Whether it be what we call a substantive analytical procedure where we predict a result at a disaggregated level using technology, or whether we do an automated re-performance of the client's processes and look for outliers and things like that. It's a much more targeted testing approach versus sampling across a wide population of information. Any other perspective from you there, Paul?
No, I think it's a great example. I think from my point of view, when we think about technology supporting the quality agenda, it is, as I mentioned earlier, it gets everything right from project management to visibility over what happens on a large multinational audit engagement to the analysis of large data sets. There are a number of areas that we can apply technology to support our people day to day with executing on high quality audits. And it's not just about getting the client data and using that, right? But it's a much broader application of technology to help on a day to day basis executing on really high quality audits.
So I think we'd be remiss if we didn't take this question here, which is, which first steps would you recommend an individual to take to start their journey into automation or analytics and things, technology, AI? I think we'd expand that.
Yeah, I mean, look, for me, Arun, there's probably no better person to speak about this than you, right? I mean, from my side, right, there's been a proliferation of no-code and low-code development tools created over the last few years that people can use and really dip their toe into the world of automation and even AI nowadays, right, for how those can be used to solve problems for professional services firms and help solve problems for and solve problems for how we deliver on our services every single day. So maybe you could just talk about a little bit about your experience, right? What are the tools that you've been using and how have you ended up in this role where you're really a client server, but also helping us build the next generation of technology?
That's right. When I was finishing up college and getting my CPA, I never would have thought that technology would have been associated with my name first before any kind of technical accounting or something like that. But like you said, proliferation of low code and no code sort of tool sets put that power into our hands a few years back. And as soon as I got my hands onto it, I was hooked and I was seeing that I had a skill set I didn't even realize I had. And what has been fascinating is seeing how easily transferable that skill set is to others. We like to use the word upskill on our audit teams. We've been able to upskill our auditors to sort of take control of the data and not even have to have specialists necessarily go in to do some of the things that we're capable of doing ourselves with a proper foundation underneath. I certainly gained a lot of expertise using some well-known workflow-driven type softwares, as well as Microsoft Power Platform, which is, I think, what got me connected to you, Paul, was some of the nice stuff we were doing there on the client ultimately got me on Paul's radar where I could start working with him a little bit more. But I think the big thing here is you don't have to be a data scientist. You don't have to have necessarily those special skill sets. And in the profession, every company pretty much is offering opportunities to learn. And I think you'll always find you learn more when you're doing it for a purpose that's for your education or for your job. You end up putting your mind into it, putting your creativity to it. And so many things are possible that weren't before. Kind of draggy, droppy software, if you will, that's helping us become more advanced by the day.
No, that's brilliant, Arun. I think great example. And I think back to the previous session on the metaverse, I think a comment was made that, you know, when you're building technology, it always has to be trying to solve a problem. And I think that in principle is true, right? Like what my advice to professionals, you know, not just familiarizing yourself with those technology tools, right? Power Apps, Power BI, Blue Prism, RPA, UiPath IPA. You don't need to be a computer scientist or a software developer to use these technologies. Right, but you can get familiar with them, watch YouTube tutorials on YouTube, experiment with building your first ideas and test apps. But my note of caution would always be this: always think about the problem you're trying to solve and don't just build automation for the sake of automation. Every technology product or successful technology product ultimately needs a business case. And so when you're developing that technology, really think about like, how are you addressing a problem here, to whether it's to improve an experience, support our ability to deliver a quality audit, make something more efficient and streamline the process. So we'd really just encourage that and always thinking with that client first mentality as well.
Yeah, well said. And I might just add that it's just that problem solving ability is what puts a CPA or an accountant in a perfect position to be a technology developer, because in our profession, we know the problems better than the engineers and the developers will. So having that hat on is especially powerful. Well, with that, I think we're at time. So is that correct?
Thanks, Paul. Thanks, Arun. I particularly appreciate your thoughts on whether technology is going to replace us, right? And what I'm hearing from you guys has been that it's not about replacement. It's about elevating what we do. It's elevating us into that kind of higher order skills of skepticism, of judgments, of building, problem solving, as you say. I remember when I was an auditor, I was building some of those technologies and it was so much fun to do that and then to be able to leverage it. So thank you again for joining us.
Thank you.
Before we take a short comfort break, I do have another question for the audience. And again, I'm going to ask you to turn back to your Slidos. Can you rank from most disruptive, number one rank, to the least disruptive, rank four? Which technology do you feel will be most disruptive to the work of a professional accountant in the next 5 years? And I've only got four choices here because I am limited, right? So I've got the metaverse, artificial intelligence, robotics process automation, or something else. And if we have a lot of people on the something else, then maybe we can think about a word cloud at some point in the next 2 days to figure out what that is. But we'll give you some time to think about what that answer is, and we'll see you back here in 15 minutes. Thanks all. digest some of the presentations you just heard in the first two sessions. Most likely you had a chance to catch up on some emails though that came through in that first hour. You know, we really need those metaverse focus tools. But so I asked our next speakers to join us, not to discuss specific technologies, but really to discuss some of their recent research around the continuous learning mindset and how it is impacted by technology for the future and for current professional accountants. Dr. Robert Kay is a co-founder and executive director of INSEP Labs. His career has moved continuously between industry and academia. He was formerly the head of strategic innovation at Westpac Banking Corporation, a senior lecturer in information systems and organizational development at the University of Technology, Sydney, and a research analyst at Bovis Lendlease. Over the past 15 years, Robert has been commissioned to undertake multiple studies of senior leaders covering topics of organizational resilience, innovation, and corporate governance. Philomena Leung is a director of education for the Institute of Public Accountants with a strong vision in business and accounting education. She was instrumental in cross-cultural and interdisciplinary education initiatives, corporate and international engagements. She is experienced in driving professional accounting education, chairing university academic boards, pioneering ethics and internal audit education, building multidisciplinary cybersecurity hubs, and modeling how new paradigms in learning for young adults. Don't forget to use your Slido screens to ask questions. And I believe there is an ability to thumbs up a question rather than retype a question that you would want posed. Over to you, Rob and Philomena. Thanks for being here today.
Thank you very much. So we'll be starting off with the first slide first. And I'm Philomena Leung. I'm representing the Institute of Public Accountants, which is one of the three authorized accounting bodies in Australia. And IPA represents 49,000 members. And in fact, as of today, it is over 50,000 members. Members and students for over 100 countries, with the including Australia, UK, China, Malaysia, India, and many other countries in Africa and Asia. It's the largest professional body representing small and medium-sized organizations and also practitioners. So that our scope of practices actually include a wide range of services, not just accounting, taxation, fund management, finance, and so on, compliance and governance, audit and risk, but also including, say, from tax advice in the smaller environment to perhaps an insolvency audit of corporates and so on. So the IPA group consists of IPA in Australia, IFA in the UK, International, the Institute of Financial Accounting, and then the AAT in Australia. And if we move to the next slide, I just want to talk a little bit about this education transformation at IPA. The education transformation at IPA actually refers to two things. One is developing and redefining the skills that are necessary for professional accountants in a competency framework. And we used competency-based education framework. And we also identify pathways that actually develop a micro-credential framework and using technology as well. So we are actually responding to IFAC's 2020, saying that we're reimagining the future accountant and then calling to action. Because there are so many new areas of behaviors, competencies, and also changing expectations of an accountant. And then in IFAC's case, it has identified digital acumen, behavioral competency, business acumen, data and synthesis, and communication. But bearing in mind, technology is actually the practical application of scientific knowledge. And we are looking at a wholly based, globally based database. And then we also look at the current members' expectations and their future expectations of their scope of work. Then applying qualitative research through interviews and also a Delphi study. And then to represent the overall skills of a globally recognized professional accountant. And these skills are also externally reviewed by an independent panel and are assessed and demonstrable. And this is actually important. And Dr. Robert Kay will be actually sharing with you how this is being done using technology and using actually the scientific way of defining this competency framework. Rob.
Thanks, Philomena. Well, I guess as we began the journey, probably we began without much technology because we decided to essentially just go and interview several accountants about what do they do during the day, not making assumptions really about the skills that are involved in accountancy. And of course, there is a diverse range of different accounting roles, as we saw within the IPA. So when we start to look at the skills that emerge from those interviews, obviously we have the traditional sort of technical skills and those that are required within the standards. But what you started to see was a much broader set of skills that emerged from what the interviewees were telling us. Digital acumen was obviously a very strong theme, picking up on what we heard with the previous speakers, you know, applications of machine learning, data analytics, the need for cryptocurrency knowledge, and cybersecurity was a very strong theme coming through in the sense that this is not an area of skill that is a nice to have. It's basically core to doing the job, was the message that we were receiving from the members who we interviewed. Interestingly, I'll not spend too much time on all of these skills, but mental health was also a very strong one, particularly through COVID. I would say that several of the people we spoke to were spending up to a third of their time providing unpaid mental health counselling for their clients because of the situation. And of course, how much training had they had to prepare them for that type of circumstance? And several of them mentioned that whilst obviously that situation had increased during the pandemic, they actually don't see it going away. They see it as being, this is just how things are. It's probably always been like that, but they're not quite as conscious of it. Social skills, of course, very important, particularly for young accountants or people joining the industry. Have they got adequate social skills? Sustainability and CSR, also a developing skill, not necessarily for all accountants, but for a growing set and particularly a body of skill that they saw would grow in importance in the future. And then, of course, because accounting is so diverse, you see accountants working across a range of activities which may not be just direct accounting, but could be in broader governance roles, etc., and so requiring those skills as well. But in terms of building a competency framework around all of this stuff, we are working very much towards doing it in the sense of micro-credentials. Now, I'm not sure how many people have come across the term micro-credentials before, but certainly in my view, this is the direction that most post-school education will head into the future. In Australia, at least, there has been a national micro-credential framework released earlier this year that defines a micro-credential, as you can see here, as a certification of assessed learning or competency with a minimum volume of learning of 1 hour or less compared to an AQF level award. AQF means the Australian Qualifications Framework, and that credential is additional, alternative, complementary to, or a component part of a formal qualification. Now, let me just unpack what this means, because in the sense of how significant this is for education, it's important that people understand a few things. The first is that what this is saying is that a micro-credential is a measure of outcomes, not inputs. Why is that significant? If we think about someone getting a degree somewhere, that degree is not necessarily a predictor of what they can do. It's a predictor that they passed exams. It's a predictor that they went through university and they studied for a certain number of hours across a certain range of topics, but it's not actually a predictor of what they can do. Hence why many of the people we interviewed said people come out of university and we more or less assume they know nothing. We have to train them. They don't have the social skills. They don't have many of those other skills that they saw as being essential to getting the work done. So with a micro-credential, the key thing is that you must be able to demonstrate the skill in order to get the credential. So that's the first point. Second point is that, as you can see, they're very small, like very, very small, could be an hour. And as I'll get onto as we work through the presentation, why that's significant is because you may not need to do a course at all. If a micro-credential comes from the demonstration of the skill, you could be quite experienced, you could be moving into a new area of accountancy, but you feel through your experience you've already know how to do whatever the credential's on, so just be assessed for it. No need to do the actual course. And so the assessment may only take an hour. Now, different countries are taking different approaches to that. I know, for example, in New Zealand, basically it's about 50 hours is as small as it gets. So different countries do have different frameworks, but at least in Australia, it is still quite flexible. And lastly, because these are small and outside a formal qualification, or they could be a small part of a qualification, you can start to think of them as being stacked a little bit like Lego bricks coming together to form a broader qualification or standard in the way that we get skilled for accountancy. So let me just unpack that for a moment. If we think about what we know, about what we actually do in the job, we can think about that in terms of units of competency rather than time. You can go through particular learning opportunities. They could be courses, it could be small micro-credentials. They could be you just working on the job for a certain period of time, and that will cover certain units of competency. Those units of competency are consistent with the units of competency that we build into the competency framework. Now, once you have that competency framework, you can then start to have micro-credentials that are layered on top of that, that are made up of the different units of competency, and certain combinations of those micro-credentials can come together to produce the professional designation. So this means that you're now in a position to develop your skills in a very flexible way, hopefully a less expensive way. And when we start to think about professional designations and the rapidly changing nature of accountancy as we go forward, we could well also imagine that it's possible that the micro-credentials that sit within those designations could change and evolve as well. So it's quite it's a much more flexible system of learning, in a sense, than probably what we have had in the past. So that competency framework, or stackable competency framework that we were talking about, we have been building. Now, this is the technology part of our talk, I suppose. And as you can see, that competency framework is drawn from a wide range of different competency frameworks from across multiple industries. And the logical reason for that is, if you cast your minds back to my first slide with the different skills that the members we interviewed said they needed, they're not just within accountancy. They come from a wide range of sources. So what we have done is accumulated from across all of these different competency frameworks, and you can see the IFAC frameworks in there as well in that list. We have produced this database, which hopefully you can see and is loading in a moment. Why this database is important is because as people want to move, I mean, another characteristic of the way in which we work these days is that our jobs change, our roles change. People are meant to have multiple careers during their life now. People will be coming into accountancy from other backgrounds, and they will want to have recognition of their prior learning. So each of these green dots that you can see here is actually a competency framework. And you can see different, there's one of the IFAC ones there. But when you think about a competency framework, all competency frameworks actually are made up of different competency domains. And those competency domains might be things like, or pretty much like that first slide that I showed. So it might include things like cybersecurity or whatever at a high level. In actual fact, these big star-shaped competency frameworks that you can see are actually cybersecurity competency framework, because they don't have any structure. But as we start to delve deeper into each of those competency domains, you'll start to see more and more competencies being filled out within it. And then what becomes interesting and significant for how we think about competencies and flexibility of learning and movement between industries and areas of learning is that within different competency frameworks, different industries will describe the same competency but using slightly different words. And so what we want to be able to do is to identify those different competencies and basically say, these are the same thing. And so that's what this database is now doing. It's identifying different competencies from different competency databases and saying, that is the equivalent of something else. And so it keeps going down into further and further depth. At the moment, we're up to about 18,000 different competencies within this database. And that will form the underpinning then of the way in which people can gain recognition of prior learning against the competency framework that IPA is developing. So that's just to give you a sense of how that is coming together. So how does all of this work then when you learn? So if you think about it on three different tiers, I think it's the easiest way to understand it. We've got the competencies, which is all of that's the little bubbles that you just saw moving around. Those competencies get drawn together into different micro-credentials. And then those different sets of micro-credentials can get drawn together into a different professional designation over time. But what's interesting is that all of these different layers can involve different data that the industry association needs to bring together and potentially from across multiple industry associations as well. So it's almost the digitization of your skills to some extent. It also means, interestingly, if you think about the way in which education has occurred in the past, you will have a course and the course will be assessed, and then that assessment leads to some form of certification. You get your degree or certificate or whatever it is. With micro-credentials and this kind of deconstruction into units of competency that I've been describing, actually that gets to break down as well. You could acquire the skill in one context but be assessed somewhere else, and then where you get the badge from could be from multiple different organisations. I'll show you what I mean by this. Let's imagine that you go and do a course at a local community college or something like that. Within that course, there could be an assessment process which is done not by the course provider, but by an external assessor. That external assessor then basically has observers or whatever method the particular skill requires to assess it. The assessment outcome is achieved, and then a credential pathway is established. And that credential pathway could go in multiple directions. It could be that in the case of the project we're working on here with IPA, you get an IPA badge. You could get the badge of the provider. You could get a badge from a different industry. And so what you're starting to see is a very flexible form of learning and credentialing of your skills enabled by technology. And I think that's pretty much all we were going to say. So we can
That's great. And I think what I just want to share that in terms of IPA, we will be using this methodology for purposes of identifying competencies and not necessarily through input, which means that it actually would show to people that you can learn as much as possible and as suitable as you can for purposes of different scopes of activities as an accountant or as a tax advisor and so on in a very flexible way, and that you have to demonstrate it. So it is actually quite a different way of learning system. It's not by number of hours, it's not by what sort of degree, and it's not necessarily a course. And I know that in the US, you have already have students in universities who can actually pick and choose what are suitable for their kind of activities for purposes of accumulating their learning. So how could actually a professional accountant, let's say, start to adapt and apply the kind of findings? In other words, we will be looking at, say, rolling out the first layer of the or the first version of the competency framework in about 2 months' time. And then we started already to engage with the professional members in such a way that they know that they are looking at different sectors of competency. And it's not just the kind of technical competencies that we have always assumed to have. As you can see that there are the particular kind of non-technical competencies, especially on digital acumen. In terms of digital acumen, as we said that the activities could be, we have got members having to actually advise other members in terms of cryptocurrency, in terms of cybersecurity, or even in terms of how to buy insurance, how to ask the right questions with the insurance company for cybersecurity assurances. So therefore, this is the kind of things that if I were a professional accountant and I have qualified many years ago, for example, and that I haven't actually taken these skills as seriously, but I've accumulated that. So therefore, I have to be making sure that I would check my the IPA website to make ensure that maybe I've got that, but I don't know. So we will be actually offering different kind of assessments to ensure that you know or you have got those competencies. But what about the younger professional accountants? Maybe how to actually adopt that sort of technology, how to be a little bit more inquisitive. As you know, the IFAC actually talks about creativity and having the inquiring mind. So a professional accountant could start by being imaginative, all right, and being observant and try to experiment with different things and with simple things in your daily life. And then you can see that technology actually can support with very simple things. So I thought that would be one way to start off. We have another question which actually asks about what are the top three activities that we believe we'll be doing differently about 5 years ago from now. And I suppose that I have to say it has happened already, all right? Because the way we collect data, we have gone beyond financial, we have gone beyond sort of the traditional way of collecting data. It is different kind of data collection method, different sources of data collection without any boundaries. And also the way we validate the data will be different. And of course, we can actually use different kind of big data to validate one set of information that we're going to use. So evidence is going to be plentiful depending on how we see the context and how we actually develop the particular factual matter. And that at the same time, I think another way is in fact, the expectation will be very different because the expectation will be that every accountant will have to have that sort of skills to be able to develop something which is innovative and which is actually not necessarily traditional. So the three things I would say that would be different will be the way we collect data, will be bound, will be actually limitless, and then the way we validate data and the way obviously that are expected of me. The other question that come up, sorry, Rob, do you have anything that you want to add?
Oh, I was just going to say that one of the things I sort of took from the interviews we conducted is the very changeable nature of, I guess, our discipline in general. So if we think about accounting as a bounded body of knowledge, I think a lot of those boundaries start to become much more permeable in the future. They start to break down. you start to be having to work across multiple different domains of activity. You'll still have a core of your technical skill, but actually what the role is in practice starts to become much more diverse and continues to evolve and change, and actually make some of that the future activities even a little bit more difficult to predict. But certainly the technology examples that Philomena gave, but also I think a lot of knowledge around the sustainability will also be quite a strong driver over the next 5 years.
Yes, I think we have actually realized that now the firms are doing, and in fact, the previous speaker were talking about ESG, and a lot of the people were using technology, looking at ESG and also looking at social matters. And nowadays, with respect of our workplace, but at the same time, how we produce our report and the way how we expect accountability. It is a much broader way of looking at it rather than just what you said, Rob, a confined way. I suppose that what is one other question here is, what is the biggest risk to a professional accountant of not leveraging technology in our education and learning? One of the things I think is important to know is learning itself has to be limitless and has to be beyond what we see in front of us. So I think if we actually do not apply that sort of technology, then we will become irrelevant. And it is just so clear in a way that when we don't leverage technology, we'll be less efficient and you'll be very much very limited. So here, there's another question. Is the Global Accounting Alliance competencies part of your analysis? And the answer is yes. All the CA and all the Global Accounting Alliance and all the big sort of alliances, all those competencies were included in the list of the competencies that we developed from the database, which is sourced globally, from IFAC, and also not necessarily just accounting. And you will realize that there are human competency or human capability framework. There are also social framework, the legal, the health organizations as such. So as we believe that it is important to understand that accounting is no longer just a single discipline. It is going to be so multidisciplinarity included in it.
I want just add to that, Philomena. There's while we have got 18,000 competencies in that database that we're drawing together into the IPA competency framework, the IPA competency framework won't have 18,000 competencies in it because our minds could potentially all melt down at the that opportunity. So what we're actually looking at is we take that as well, we call that the universe of competencies, and we basically from within that universe cull out all the ones that we think are not relevant based on the interviews that we've done with the accountants. And then, of course, there's also standards and regulatory requirements that mean that certain competencies have to be there as well. And so it's from this sort of process of elimination that we then get it down to what the final set of competencies will be. Interestingly, we're also using a Delphi method in the sense that we're surveying members of the IPA around particular competency areas where, like, if we take cybersecurity as an example, most accountants won't need to know how to code a firewall themselves. That's probably outside the scope of what most accounting practices would require, but they do need to know what a firewall is. So testing where those boundaries are, we've done by using a survey method called Delphi with members to work out where do people see the boundary of that knowledge is. So, you know, there was sort of 250-odd cybersecurity competencies that we've got to whittle down to, say, 50 or 60, something like that, that is actually relevant to accounting practice.
The Delphi method is very much a recognized research method that some of you actually know. And really, it is actually a way of making sure a person responding is actually reaffirming or looking at the context and trying to also question themselves whether a particular answer that they themselves give are correct or are what they believe in. So the Delphi study survey method is actually also reaffirming our competencies that we that we have actually developed through those databases. So it's another scientific way of making sure that it is actually sure proof. I suppose one of the things is just to ask you, Rob, what are the final, do you have any final reflection? I mean, now you've done so much research for IPA member and the professional body as such. And of course, I think there's a lot to learn and I have learned a lot. What about you, Rob?
I think the challenge that we face is how we can capture it in succinct words that is easy for everybody to understand, particularly for some of the competencies. It's interesting when you look across this wide variety of competency frameworks. I do wonder how some of them have been created because some of the things in them just aren't even really competencies. They're collections of sentences of multiple things all jammed together and they've called that a competency. It's like, well, yeah, no, that one's out. So we have to getting the wording right so it is a competency that members can understand and they go, yes, I need to actually be able to do that because that resonates with what I do in my daily life, but I realize that I'm not well enough skilled in that, or I would like to learn more about that, or whatever it is. So I think the challenge that we have moving forward is whilst we've got a lot of information here, we have to turn that into something which is much more meaningful for members, meaningful for practitioners, so that they can actually use that to inform their learning. And then they can leverage the whole sort of micro-credential competency-based model to more rapidly learn and direct their own professional development. So that it should in theory make it much easier to stay up to date. So that when we say, you know, how is technology changing accounting or whatever, well, actually we don't necessarily need to ask it because everybody's constantly doing it and updating it. It's not a challenge of what's the next big course I need to do because there's a 3-hour one that you can click on and you can get what you need and you can be credentialed for it. And it's like, yeah, well, that actually got me the next step that I needed to be to now go, oh, now there's actually that other course that would be useful as well. So I think there'll be a period of adjustment for many people, I think, in the sense that they haven't had this level of freedom in the way they could learn before. And they have to learn to take it up.
Yeah, and my final reflection really is after 46 years in academia, I have to say that one thing that has taught me is I got to engage with the practice. And I also want to make sure that I'm also one step ahead of the practice so that I can think and be imaginative. So I think that is, first of all, I need to engage and learn and always be open-minded. I think that's actually very important to me. And thank you very much. Thanks, Helen, and thank you, Rob. I think our time is up. Yep.
Yes, thanks, Rob. Thanks, Philomena. In addition to an insightful presentation, what a great case study in using data to really start a revolution or an evolution, like a shift in the mindset of how we think about education. I really like the possibilities of the micro-credential concepts. I think it would be a great way to help professional accountants, as you say, Rob, remain relevant to really like, and the mobility, as I think somebody suggested on the Slido. I think it's a great, great thing. So thank you.
Thank you.
So before I turn to our last session of the day, I do want to ask you to again visit your Slido and help me collectively create a word cloud of what do you see as the biggest risk to the accounting profession of professional accountants not embracing technology? And we've asked, as you may have seen, we've asked that a couple of times throughout the day. So I'd be curious of what the audience thinks. And again, this question was inspired really as I met with our next speakers, and I'm sure you'll hear about their lens, but with respect to fintech. While you're filling out that word cloud, so for our next session, the future of fintech, we will hear from experts in financial technologies on their view of the impact of financial technologies and the role of the profession. Some of the initiatives at the International Organization of Securities Commissions, or IOSCO, as well as a digitalization journey at the Standard Chartered Bank of Uganda. Chuck Salter, Senior Vice President, Editorial at Edelman New York, will moderate the discussion. Now, Chuck oversees the editorial strategy and content for companies and organizations, helping them to tell timely and social-driven stories with a journalistic sensibility across digital, video, print, and on stage. Prior to Edelman, he covered innovation for 20 years as a nationally award-winning senior writer and senior editor at Fast Company, where he profiled many of the world's leading companies. So turning to the word cloud, I'm seeing a lot of getting left behind, being obsolete, irrelevance, inefficiency, obsolescence. That relevance tone is really starting to resonate. And Chuck, and maybe I can pass over to you. It's still going, so I'm not sure if you can see it, but we'll come back afterwards. And maybe at some point you can pose a question to Cameron and Sanjay for me. Thanks, Chuck.
Yeah, that sounds great. Thank you so much. It's great to be here today and such a pleasure to join the summit. I'm finding the word cloud pretty mesmerizing myself, and to see certain words are staying right at the center, at the heart of the conversation, the concerns. So I've also been just following some of the comments in the poll earlier today, and it's really so illuminating to see what's on everyone's mind, especially around technologies that you think will be, you know, disruptive in the years ahead. That's what we're going to be exploring some today. You know, the trajectory and impact of AI, metaverse, robotics process automation, these sorts of things. And what one thing I've noticed is in the questions, there's both a desire to figure out the best path forward, as well as an underlying concern that comes through in questions like, does future tech minimize the role of accountants and auditors? And what's the future of human accountants in a decade, suggesting a real tension between technology and humans? These are great questions, and we think the best way to address these and more is to hear from people working on the front lines. So you're gonna hear a couple different perspectives today, really that of that of a regulator and a practitioner. So first up, we have Cameron Carr, who's going to share this regulatory perspective. Cameron is a policy advisor at the International Organization of Securities and Commissions, where he's on the Emerging Regulatory Issues team. So he's working on policy related to fintech, such as developing global standards for decentralized finance and crypto assets. And speaking as a practitioner, someone running a business and leveraging all that fintech can do, is Sanjay Rugani. Sanjay is the CEO of Standard Chartered Bank in Uganda. It's the country's oldest commercial bank, dating back to 1912. And he's been leading its continuing transformation by leveraging AI and blockchain and other technologies that we'll explore today. And as you probably know, he serves as the chair of the IFAC Professional Accountants and Business Advisory Group. So welcome, Cameron and Sanjay. I want to get started really with your overall sense of where we're headed. So Cameron, let's hear from you first. What does the future of financial technology look like to you?
Thanks, Chuck. And thanks, Helen, and everyone at IFAC for inviting me here today. I think it's probably unsurprising. My perspective on the future of fintech is that it's a regulated future, one where we see the sort of risks that exist currently in terms of transparency, in terms of investor protection, in terms of a fundamental lack of disclosure. What we're seeking to do at the moment is address those risks and provide an environment that is regulated, transparent, and ultimately risk assured. I think what we've seen, and maybe just to give a bit of context, our focus, as you mentioned, is primarily on decentralized finance and crypto assets at the moment. It's a key concern for securities markets regulators, both from a conduct point of view, but also just generally from a use of technology and the use cases that we've seen to date. So with that, we're turning our attention to addressing the sort of investor protection and market integrity risks that exist currently. In order to do that, we bring together the securities markets regulators from around the globe, who all have different levels of expertise and experience. Some will have seen more scams and frauds. Others will have seen more, you know, practical uses of the technology. What we're trying to do is ensure that we have a baseline standard at a global level that allows a sort of trickle-down effect to domestic regimes and ultimately adopting a consistent regulatory framework that provides that sort of regulatory clarity that I think everyone needs, whether it's investors, whether it's professional services, whether it's regulators ourselves. And at the moment, what we've seen over the last, you know, 10, 12 years since Bitcoin came on the scene is that we don't have that level of legitimacy or assurance at this point in time. So that's what we're working towards. So I hope to say in the next year or two that we'll have a consistent regulatory framework that can be adopted for, in particular, crypto and DeFi. And then I think we can turn our attention more to looking at how to use the technology in financial services rather than focusing on addressing the risks. So that's kind of my two cents on the future of fintech, Chuck.
Okay, thanks, Cameron. So the future of fintech is regulated from Cameron's standpoint. Sanjay, how about you? What does the future look like from where you're sitting?
I think I really like what Cameron said, and I kind of agree. But from where I sit as a banker and also driving the profession, I actually think that the future is much more about survival and relevance. And yes, regulatory is clearly a very key component of this. Maybe to give you context, you know, for our listeners, there was a big study done by the World Economic Forum in the year 2018, which talks about the future of work. Now, the study kind of really looks at all different professions. And there were two very important revelations really linked to the accounting or the finance profession. There was a big sense that, you know, as a profession, we are actually becoming outdated, you know, that the profession is one of those that in future will have less relevance. On the other hand, you know, the study talked about that the number of jobs in the world will continue to grow. There's going to be so much more, at least 50 million more jobs compared to those that will be lost. And the study kind of, you know, indicated that, you know, the more you embrace two things, really, it's not just, you know, digital, but digital and sustainability, which are probably the world's two biggest disruptors, then you continue to survive and be more relevant. So at the time the study was being done, a general view of having taken stock of thousands of businesses, was that the accounting profession did not optimize both on the technology potential and the human potential, because we had humans doing what technology is supposed to do. And some of us were spending money on technology, but never optimizing on it. And the general sense was that only 29% of the overall, and remember, some of them were already fintechs, 29% of the work that we did was digitized or automated. On the other hand, it also spoke about the potential of getting that to 62% as an optimal state. And this is much more also looking at, you know, so what's the demand of the finance function or the accounting profession? So a lot of feedback on that from different stakeholders, regulators, you know, customers, internal stakeholders, you know, shareholders. But I think what I'm saying is that for us to be able to respond to the multiple demands that our profession faces, you know, survival and both relevance are critical. Thanks.
Sanjay, I feel like you're channeling the word cloud with those concerns about irrelevance. So that was spot on. Cameron, let me go back to you for a minute about the, just to follow up on that vision of a regulated future. What is IOSCO, you know, doing today to adapt to help put that in place? Any examples of you know, a project or a case study that really illustrates that?
Yeah, sure thing, Chuck. So in March of this year, we established a fintech task force. So this is definitely not our first work in the crypto asset space. It's been a priority for IOSCO since 2017. But what we did in March is really move from a sort of information-seeking analytical stage into policy development and policy formation. And as I mentioned there, the real focus of this policy is to address investor protection and market integrity risks. So we've set up two work streams, one on crypto and digital assets, and one on decentralized finance. And through those work streams, by the end of 2023, we will come out with global policy recommendations and high-level principles that will enable regulators globally to build out their domestic frameworks. I think, you know, in the lead up to this, one of the key focuses for us has been to provide a sort of regulatory toolkit. So in the absence of having a domestic framework or a policy stance, at least giving regulators the tools to build their own capacity and to understand the sorts of risks that exist in the market was our way of sort of in the meantime, getting to that point. I think in terms of an example, one of the ones that really comes to mind is Facebook Libra and I guess DM as it evolved into. What we saw there is a sort of awareness from regulators and central banks that, you know, in the absence of regulators stepping up to use technology and evolve as the market evolves, big tech and other sort of, you know, big players in the market will step in to try and fill that role. So it was quite a positive development from my perspective, insofar as it did sort of light that fire and bring about this sort of fundamental change in how we looked at technology and DLT and stablecoins, and acknowledge that you can't really bury your head in the sand. You need to step up and understand that in the absence of action from a regulatory authority, monetary policy might shift into a sort of private sector environment, particularly in those sorts of areas where entities have such large market share and there's a sense of ambiguity around how to regulate big tech given the level of access they have to data, in conjunction with the market share that they have. So I think that was probably quite an illuminating moment from a regulatory standpoint in looking at big tech and crypto and seeing the sort of potential it could have in the absence of regulation. So there was a lot of work done by the FSB. A lot of central banks came together and said, what does Libra mean? And what we've seen now in the last couple of years is real efforts made globally to look at the potential for CBDCs, central bank digital currencies, as a means to sort of act as the second half to the crypto asset universe. So that's sort of the vision and where it came from, I guess.
That's great. So really, it's like you're setting up new task force that are going to focus on specific technologies to start to set up a framework that leads to policy. It's a change in terms of how the organization is operated. Sanjay, how about you? How has Standard Chartered Bank, to your point about the future of survival, how have you set yourselves up to survive? What are you doing differently to prepare for what's coming?
Chuck, it's very important to also say that Standard Chartered Bank has been in existence close to 170 years, in Uganda, 110 years. We are a developing market bank. You know, we tend to cover Africa, Asia, Middle East. And typically the jury is out, but I think we cover close to 2/3 of the world in different senses. Now you'll appreciate that the most regulated industry is, you know, is really the banking sector. And everything that happens, the banking sector is in the center of everything. So the speed at which we need to continue to evolve is becoming megafold. And in a world where now we have competition from mobile companies, from fintechs, and regulators are constantly clamping down on business because of their different mindsets. Myself also, before I became a CEO, I used to be a CFO for a country, then a cluster, and then I became a global head of shared services for finance. Just wanted to give that context. Standard Chartered Bank took two different phases of evolution when it comes to technology and digitization. The first phase was really to make sure that we centralize as much as possible. So we came up with a concept of, you know, center of excellence, shared services center, as we call it. And a lot of our work in country became globalized. And we really took benchmarking and said, so what's the best in class that can happen? And a lot of work was put in to really automate simple processes, repetitive work, really looking at the whole area of accounts payable, so which is very, very much driven by, you know, repetitive work in essence. So we looked at reducing cost as a benefit. We looked at increasing efficiency. We took everything routine, made sure that, you know, processes became straight through. And also it also significantly enhanced our reliability. With all that comes a lot of education. So we really took time to build competency, hire the right people. Now, the phase that we are in now is really about big time survival. And, you know, this is really about being moving from evolution to constant revolution because of the number of markets we cover. So things like big data, you know, really artificial intelligence, cloud, RPA are the game now, you know, and this is really because our thinking pattern is that the demands of our stakeholders, be it regulators, clients, internal stakeholders, shareholders, are becoming so big. So we need to become a self-service model. We have to have predictive skills on what is expected. We are really providing much more insights, you know, so that the business can drive bigger decisions. And then you will appreciate that the business has a different language to accounting. So I think as an accounting function or finance function, we're becoming much more driven by how the business can listen to us and can be influenced. So we use much more their language. So that's the kind of, you know, transformation that we've gone through. I must say that we've still not hit the optimal status, but if you had to take consideration that maybe a decade ago we were, you know, close to 23-27% automated, we're hitting the highs of, you know, close to 50-60% now, and we can only enhance on that. Thanks.
That's great, Sanjay. And just to follow up there, you mentioned, you know, accountants and their role in this. Talk a little bit about, you know, this greater role that accountants could play, and really the, you know, the part two of that question is how do accountants get a seat at the table when it comes to fintech?
That's a very, very important question, because I think this is where the transformation is. Just to step back, I think where the world is today, very complex, very volatile, very vulnerable, you know, accountants sit at an inflection point, you know, with a lot much more trust demanded. I think as a profession, we are best suited to meet some of the biggest challenges, which means we have to spend time doing the right things. So really, a lot of our value should be driven by appreciating what's the output demanded. You know, in the past, we were just giving data insights as bookkeepers, records, and a lot much more of our conversation was past looking. Now it's we have to be much more future focused. And I think that's where you have much more bigger seat on the table, because everybody wants to know what's the future rather than the past. The amount of information, you know, that is there, or the information pollution that is there, you know, you're constantly being hit by the current status. What is important is what's the future. The second thing is really where you become so much more focused to drive, you know, the principles of ESG, SDGs. So as a finance function, the more you automate, the more you put things on cloud repository, one, access becomes exciting, but two, you're really reducing the carbon impact. You know, so we become a force for good as a function. And I think this is a big role that the function can play. The third is, you know, there was a study that showed that out of the multiple zettabytes that of data that is being produced, frankly, accountants were only using 0.5% of it. So as organizations like ours, you know, we have really started optimizing on data. Data, as we know, is a new goal. You know, you can take behavioral trends, you can prioritize where to spend time, you can create new strategies, you are able to, you know, look at the current world, you're able to do multiple simulations using data. So I think that's a big value that allows now everybody on the board seat or governance seat to recognize the big impact and influence that finance can meet. The other thing is really output. You know, I've been in the bank 23 years, and frankly, something that when I started my job, 40 of us could do in the finance function, now two people can do, and, you know, we have 400 times more output. So think about the power of revolution, as I said, transformation that technology is bringing in. The more you are able to demonstrate where you were maybe a decade ago and where you are now, you know, clearly you earn so much more, you know, sit on the table, but much more also from a value context, you can demonstrate that. I think the final thing is, you know, the world demands you have to constantly be change mindset driven, you know, growth mindset driven. And I think this is a big area of value. You know, accountants by nature, with the competency we have and the learning we've done, we are very disciplined. At the same time, you know, we really appreciate the whole, there's only one language of business in the world, that is accountancy. So why not leverage that to transform the world that we are part of? You know, I think those are the big benefits and gives us a bigger seat on the table.
It's interesting you use the word discipline. Cameron, I think of that with regulators as well. There is this, you hear this notion of being able to work slow and fast at the same time, that like that's kind of the new paradox that's required of companies. I'm thinking it applies to regulators as well. Tell us, talk a little bit about how do you regulate innovation without stifling it?
It's a great question, Chuck. And I think that's one of the challenges we grapple with in terms of ensuring that our output is useful in the long term, particularly at a global level. It's all well and good to develop standards in the space of 6 months, but if they're obsolete or irrelevant or don't take account of specific nuance in the market within the next 6 months, then they become irrelevant. So I think I mentioned earlier how we're moving now from information seeking sort of collaboration and analysis into, you know, true policy development stage. That's come about from all the work that we've been doing over the past 5 to 10 years. So that stems from, you know, innovation hubs, facilitators, regulatory sandboxes, various forms of engagement that we have with both, you know, regulated entities, but also those that may not fall to be regulated, to give us that sort of context on the market. They may not fall to be regulated themselves, but they have a sort of insight and interaction with key players that would fall to be regulated. So I think one of the key things for us is striking that balance between, you know, having an open dialogue, but also understanding at the end of the day that where we're trying to get to may not be suitable to everyone in the market. So our process is really about ensuring that we're well informed before we come to the stage that we put pen to paper and start developing rules and guidance and recommendations to ensure that they're suited to the market. But also that they achieve our regulatory outcomes, primarily being, you know, fair and efficient markets, but equally ensuring investors are protected and there aren't manipulative activities being permitted by the key players in the market. So I think, yeah, ultimately our goal is to regulate, but from an overarching standpoint, there is an acknowledgement that technology provides the opportunity for innovation and that regulation needs to take account of that. And I think we'll end up in a place where we manage to regulate without stifling innovation while also mitigating these risks that we've seen over the past number of years. I think that's how we go about regulating without stifling.
Right. Part of what strikes me is you're both. Oh, go ahead, Sanjay. Yeah.
I actually wanted to add a context to that. You know, I, in my role just before this one, I was the CEO for Standard Chartered Bank in Tanzania, but also the deputy chairman of the Bankers Association. We used to have constant engagement and sometimes constant conflict with our regulators because, you know, as an industry, as an organization, we've got to continue to evolve. You know, the demands of our customers, clients, stakeholders are changing. And many times the regulators, you know, are very driven by a mindset of policy. Policy is the worst thing for innovation. You know, now what has happened is we have two key concepts that are very prominent. One is a code of conduct or practice. I think we need to empower individuals and organizations to self-regulate, and that can happen through a code of practice or code of conduct. And for accountants, this is great. You know, as a profession, we are born with a code of practice. So, you know, that's good. But the other thing is that, you know, regulators more and more should move away from real hardcore policies to frameworks, because frameworks allow within reasons to innovate and you know, continue to evolve is probably the right word here. So I really like what Cameron said, but, you know, this is a constant battle in the banking sector also. Thanks.
Cameron, what's your sense? Is that sort of approach to frameworks you know, make sense to you, or you know, when do you feel the, you know, you need to make a you know, a bigger step in terms of regulation? How do you decide you've reached that point?
I think the framework piece, particularly in the crypto asset space, has come and gone from to some extent. So we developed a digital asset support framework in 2018 with the view to giving regulators the sort of softer tools to regulate the market. What we've seen over the past number of years is, in the absence of, I guess, firmer or bolder or more black and white requirements, concerns around conflicts of interest, a lack of disclosure, manipulative behaviors have been permitted in effect. So I guess when you see the level of risk and the level of retail participation that we've seen, the need to sort of instill some good market practice, the time has come, I would say, particularly in the crypto asset space. And as I mentioned earlier, I think once that sort of platform is set, I think we can then focus on, you know, how can this technology be used by financial services companies more effectively, rather than worrying about, I guess, basic principles of securities markets regulation being instilled in the market. Because once that sort of, you know, upper boundary is set, then we can turn our attention to, okay, how can this technology be used to improve some of the sort of back end processes in asset management? Or can we look at the tokenization of financial instruments and look at improving settlement? Unfortunately, our attention is kind of been focused elsewhere, given the developments in the market, the likes of Terra Luna, and just general concerns for the retail investors that are coming into this market over the past number of years. So it is an inherent challenge, as Sanjay alluded to there. But our concern is really on the risks, and the risks have not been mitigated to date, and hence why we need, I guess, more black and white rules and guidance, as opposed to like a kind of more overarching framework, because we've sort of been there and done that in this space.
Go ahead.
Sorry, I just wanted to add, that's why I said that there is a code of conduct which outlines the do's and don'ts, and there is a framework that allows the innovation. So, but I like what Cameron has said. Thank you.
You're both having to educate yourselves about, this is the industry, right, that we're living. Like, there's new technology coming. You have to educate yourselves about the opportunity, about the risk. How do you, both from a practitioner standpoint and a regulatory standpoint, how do you know that you know enough to act? Sanjay, in your point of view, how do you know enough about a given technology to experiment with it, to try it, to implement it in the business? And then Cameron, I'll turn back to you in terms of how do you know enough to step in with, you know, with a framework in the beginning of that process. Sanjay, how about you first?
Well, I think the pace at which the world is changing, this concept of you know it enough is never enough. It's never going to be there. I think most of us, good businesses work on the models of 80-20. You know, you can always, you know, this is a game of, hunt for perfection versus hunting for progress. And there's never a point where it's perfect, because tomorrow things will change. So for us, we play the game of 80-20. What we also do is genuinely, get to the 80% and start engaging our regulators, you know, so that there is an alignment model. We also look at the current regulations and are very strict to do a gap analysis on our desired, end goal versus where the world is today. And this is where you have to have a session of meeting of minds, because the regulations may sometimes need to be changed, or they can be interpreted. You know, you get practitioners' note and says, oh, by the way, this regulation also means you could do this, really in a sense. But I think what we also do is, we have a constant model really around learning. And a lot of it is really around collaborative learning nowadays. You know, we call it the concept of co-creation. So you find the partners that are evolving and then work with them constantly, because otherwise we get caught up. You know, so alliances is a game, co-creation, collaboration. We know we don't know it all, but we have to, deliver greater value to our clients. So you work with the right partners, per se. That's our model.
Cameron, how about you? And that question of when do you know, how do you know enough to begin to step in with, you know, framework and so forth?
I think in this space, and the whole capacity building concept was discussed on the previous panel, and it's integral really to this space, because arguably you never know enough, because it's changing at such a fierce rate. So you may have people that are experts in securities law, but they're unlikely to also be computer scientists and programming the code behind a smart contract, for example. So the challenge is that, you know, logically, and if you approach this in a reasonable manner, you don't know enough at any point in time, or you don't know everything. Hence why, you know, as Sanjay alluded to, the need for sort of code of conducts and principles-based regulation allows that sort of trickle-down effect and interpretation, both for individual sectors and different types of entities, but also for different regulatory frameworks across the globe. So inherently, there might be a different approach to regulation in the EU versus the US, and they may be moving at different speeds. But I think what we do know is that they'll end up with a similar aim or a similar objective, which is, in our space anyway, investor protection and market integrity. So how do you know enough? Well, I think from our perspective, we know enough from what we've seen from a risk standpoint, and that it needs regulation in order to mitigate those risks. But I think we would admit ourselves that we're constantly learning and constantly trying to take in all these different perspectives from industry, academia, consumer research groups, advocacy. So it's about being as informed as possible without thinking that you know it all, particularly in a space as dynamic as this.
Yeah. Thanks. Sanjay, were you going to step in? Sorry.
No, I really like what he said, and this is true to almost all the industries now, you know. But I think what is important is you look at risk from two perspectives. You look at risk from the best case scenario and the worst case scenario, because the chances of being uprooted are so big nowadays. You know, you could have one regulation and you're doomed, or you could have one interference or one global issue that comes in. So I think it's just looking at risk from both sides. Thank you.
Yep. One thing that comes through is the what we don't, you can't know enough. That's the theme you both addressed. You can't know everything. You're trying to figure out, do I know enough to act? I'm curious for each of you to address this question of, you know, what's a trend or an area that people often fail to understand about the future of fintech that accountants really should be aware of now? This is like a gap in their knowledge. Let's see, Sanjay, you want to take that?
You know, I think that the value of being constantly evolving is very critical. So big things that I think that if I have to just look at my organization where I still think that there is opportunity for accountants is, we talked about data, for example. I think the value of data is so much more substantial, and their ability to become co-pilots in the journey of business. You know, a lot of accountants think that their work stops at reporting. So I think that's a big, big, big area, I think, which is will continue to evolve. The second thing is, including something that we talked in the previous session is, you know, the world is demanding more both numerical or financial data, and a lot much more collaboration with non-financial data. So creating those synergies between financial and non-financial data, especially if we are looking at, let's say, integrated accounts or sustainable accounts, you know, there's just so much more value that is there. The third area for me is really the pace at which decisions can be made. You know, so every accountant should question, you know, what am I doing that is creating good decisions constantly? And you know, how are you making yourself relevant? The fourth is, and this is very nice, Cameron said that, you know, the world is changing at a fierce pace. So think about the area of talent. I mean, if accountants continue to be using, you know, the past models, you're really going to lose talent, because the new generation of talent wants to be agile, wants to be evolving, wants to create revolution, wants to create transformation, but they're also purpose-led. So how do you connect them using numbers, you know, to connect with the bigger purpose ambitions? And then finally, I think that, look, we are facing a perfect storm in this world. the rigidity of accountants sometimes, and this may not be for my organization, but in general, we are never ready for black swan events. And every day nowadays, there is a black swan event. So, you know, how much more can you benefit by being just ready for evolution? Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a good way to put it. Cameron, how about you? What's a trend or an area that people fail to understand about the future of fintech?
To be fair, I think Sanjay covered off a lot of it there. And I would agree with a lot of the sentiment that you've covered. I think certainly data, but also I think the need to approach fintech and the actors in the space with a healthy dose of skepticism. I think we saw what happened with Wirecard. There's been a lot of, you know, as you say, black swan events, but also perceived legitimacy or transparency that may not actually be the case. And I think the need to really dig down and while also building your capacity, but also just understanding the entity that you're dealing with and the sort of the data that you're handling. And I think there certainly in the blockchain crypto space, there can be this myth of transparency that exists where there's this notion that everything is on chain, we can see everything, but in practice, that's not really the whole of it. And there's a lot of off-chain activity, a lot of poorly lit areas that need to have a light shown on them. And I think it would be important as much for regulators to do that, for accountants and auditors to do that as well.
How do you reconcile that need for more transparency with the desire for speed? It seems like they can be a little bit, you know, at odds with one another. How do we address that?
I really think it's about building data capabilities and kind of meshing quantitative and qualitative data with sort of subject matter expertise from all those different perspectives. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that just takes time, quite frankly. And I think that needs to be acknowledged, that if you rush these things without all that considered, measured input, you won't end up with the right result, and it'll be outdated in you know, a very, very, very fast period.
So what do you think are the, and Sanjay, I'll go to you first for this. What are the biggest risks accountants should consider when working with fintech or innovative finance companies today?
I think multiple things. A lot of fintech companies are not as regulated as some of the bigger organizations are, you know, whether it's the Cameron's world or my world. Fintechs are there to take risk. Their entire existence is to really scale, you know, and take as much market share as possible. Whereas, you know, our models are much more, they're not conservative per se, but I think they're more sensible. You know, so the whole area of risk is very critical. So number one. Number two is the evolution of fintechs has a lot of gaps on corporate governance structures, you know, and you know, whether it is consumer protection, whether it is having the right kind of, you know, mindset around making sure that you're doing all the right things, you know, whether it is for the organization, for a long-term, looking at the world from a long-term perspective. You know, they just evolve. They happen overnight. They don't have structures. They don't have models. So that's the other thing. The third is that fintechs have a very narrow mindset. You know, they look at the world from their own eyes, and their eyes is like, this is my zone. I'm going to play big in that. So they tend to miss out on the many other implications they have, particularly working with organizations like ours. Then there is the whole area of establishing good principles of work, you know, including labor practices, making sure that you're doing good reporting, really looking at the world from a perspective of sustainability, you know, moving to becoming more purpose-driven. So there are those fintechs that are particularly purpose-driven. I think those are good, but ultimately this is an area that so. The big risk is really that their failure could become your failure, and you could become tainted very, very quick. And remember, fintechs are very present in the social world. So one failure can become a brand disaster sometimes. So there are those multiple angles that you need to really look at. And then finally, sometimes you feel scared. You know, their speed of, you know, adaptation is insane. You could even worry your client sometimes, you know, so you just have to be more sensible. Thanks.
Cameron, I'm going to go to you, and I know I'm channeling your earlier answer about having a healthy dose of skepticism, but what do you consider, aside from that, what do you consider the biggest risk accountants should consider when working with fintech or innovative financial companies?
Yeah, I think corporate governance is certainly an important one, given the development of a lot of these entities without traditional frameworks applying. And certainly their focus is more on scaling up and, you know, grabbing market share and increasing revenues and getting into profit territory. So those are some of the sort of basic things you need to consider. I think also in terms of the technology itself, I guess, does the fintech fully understand the operational risk that exists? Has it tested it? Are there appropriate policies and procedures in place to frame the use of the technology? Is it being done in a pilot setting, tested environment prior to full deployment? I think there's a lot of different things to consider, but certainly the fact that they understand the risks that their business is exposing them to, and have they taken steps to mitigate those risks? And is it on paper? And then, as Sanjay said, are they good at reporting? Is their data of high quality? Have they got the basics down? And then they can look to take over the market.
Right. No, that's good.
I want to just add one more thing to what Cameron said, and just thinking about, you know, his perspective from a regulatory angle. So if you think about regulators, the other important factor for regulators is your ability to come out of, the whole area of business contingency and disaster recovery. Fintechs are very poor with that, including, you know, sometimes these fintechs are very driven by 1-2 person identity. So the IPs, you know, if one person moves, it becomes a big chaos for the organization. So I just wanted to add those bits. Thanks.
Yeah. So we've touched on opportunities here in this future of fintech. We've touched on the risk. We touched on like how to innovate, but also how to regulate that innovation. I want to end on something practical for our audience today. I'd like you to think about how we can basically help them prepare accountancy for this future that you've described. So share one or two things that they can do today to best, you know, future-proof themselves and perhaps their organization. Cameron, would you like to go first?
I think I'm probably going to stick with the theme of capacity building here, in that it doesn't necessarily need to be all credentials-based, but certainly this, you know, will to continuously learn and to stay up to date on developments and not ignore the evolutions that are taking place around you. I think certainly in the fintech space, every single day there's a new piece of technology being deployed, a new entity on the scene. So I just say that, you know, leaving aside perhaps taking the next course, it's more about just day to day, you know, keeping up to speed on what's happening in current affairs in the market, and ensuring that you stay up to speed with things. So it's I guess not too dissimilar to our last panel, but really it is that is a core consideration in this space.
Sanjay, how about you?
So I first of all agree the capacity piece, because we are in an ever-evolving space. But I have a few other things. I think we are in a very unique time in this world. The biggest thing haunting us is trust. You know, you really can't trust anything at the moment, you know, because the world is extremely volatile. I think accountants, like a few other professions, have a unique opportunity to bring in more trust, you know, to really bring in more structure, to bring more sustainability to this world. And for that, we have to take much more demanding leadership role. You know, we've got to be leading by example. We've got to stand up. So things that are necessary is really, we really have to have the right information and use the language of our stakeholders to influence and impact. I think thought leadership is one of the biggest things accountants can do, because in a very narrow mindset, you know, that even a lot of leaders are becoming too nationalistic nowadays. So what's the role of the accountant? Think about it that, you know, again, the other thing is really information provision. you know, provide good information, because everybody's mindset is really looking at risk. So we can bring that balance into the equation. The third thing for me is really the area of sustainability. I think accountants have to be more bolder. The risks, you know, if we think that COVID was a pandemic, I think the biggest pandemic is climate. And what's the role of the accountants in becoming bigger champions of climate? So if you connect every financial data with carbon data, drive the right reporting. So accountants have to create more value for the society, and that way they become more valuable. And then finally is just being change ready. You know, the world is never going to be static, you know. So those are the opportunities.
That's great. Cameron and Sanjay, thank you so much for your thoughts today. I feel like I'm gonna add my own version of the future of fintech. The future of fintech is led by accountants. That's a question mark, because it could be when you talk about this leadership moment and the need to disrupt yourself and the need to work beyond just data reporting to have a seat at the table earlier in the process. That sounds like a great opportunity to take advantage of there. Helen, have we covered everything in that word cloud? I feel like we addressed a lot of those themes and concerns that were coming through.
I think you got everything in there and then some. That was a fantastic conversation and certainly enlightening. What I'm hearing is that there is a need to take on technology, to take the risk, to take the opportunities that are presented to us. And it's really, it's ours to lose, right? And so I appreciate the collaboration between the regulators and then the practitioners in this, because the regulators are what drive a lot of the work we do. And it's up to the accountants to take it on and figure out how do we take the technologies and make them work for us? So I very much appreciate it. Thank you, Chuck. Thank you, Cameron. Thank you, Sanjay. And thank you to our speakers today. Thank you to Ben and Paul and Arun and Rob and Philomena for all of the support in today's content and pulling it together. There's some really highly thought-provoking presentations. Today, the possibilities of what we could do with technology and the need to do something stood out. The phrase remaining relevant as always speaks to me. And I know you'll hear more about this tomorrow. But just again, to recap, so Ben gave us an excellent peek at the possibilities of the metaverse and what that can provide us in the future. Paul and Arun have really kind of encouraged us to take on new technologies, to embrace that the RPA and the artificial intelligence. Philomena and Rob gave us some food for thought with revolutionizing how we learn and that concept of micro-credentials. And again, Sanjay and Cameron left me with a message, and Chuck, the embracing fintech. And I think I can safely broaden that to all technology is crucial to the profession's survival. I'm seeing a lot of noise in the chat about, are we going to lose our jobs? Is the profession going to die? And I truly believe that is not the case, because I think the role of an accountant, the quality, the integrity that we give to reporting is so, so important to society. The risk that we have is somebody's going to try and take our job, right? Because that job is needed, that role is needed. And technology, leveraging that technology, gives us some efficiency that allows us to do more, allows us to delve into ESG, to drive value to society. So my personal take on it is that we are not dying. We need to evolve, which is hopefully going to help us attract new people as well. And so I did mention earlier that attracting new talent to the profession is something that we are considering within IFAC Accounting Education. I've started those dialogues with education leads at a number of professional organizations. Statements like remaining relevant are really what resonates and encourages me to keep going with those dialogues. More to come in this space, and I have a couple other questions for you later in the conference, so stay tuned. I do believe there is one more Slido question for you to rate today's session. And with that, I thank you again for your encouragement, your engagement, your attention. And I look forward to another series of informative and hopefully somewhat inspiring sessions tomorrow. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.